First off, let's check this header out. So you see initially I had the thing straight up forward facing. I wasn't able to put the turbocharger there because I just couldn't make the bend out of the downpipe. The 5-inch diameter downpipe really limits you on what you're able to do for turn radius. And it was running into the water pump pulley. So we moved the turbocharger on a little bit of an angle to be able to achieve the exhaust flow we were looking for out of that back side of that. The header is unique in that it is a 180 degree header. What that means is it takes every cylinder from every other cylinder in the firing order to one bank and all the other cylinders to another bank. So basically you have two cylinders from one bank to one collector and two cylinders from the other bank to that same collector and the same on the other side. It makes the pulses to the turbine wheel a little bit more consistent. I'll be honest, I wasn't really doing this header build as a performance gain. I did the header that way because I wanted to do something that was unique. There's a lot of turbo coyotes out there. It's hard to stand out amongst the crowd, right? So this thing has a very unique sound to it. So yeah, you see the header, there's a couple issues with it. The primary tube length is obviously longer than ideal. Header is just, I bet the thing weighs 50, 60 pounds. It's heavy. It is all thin wall 304, but it is still very heavy. Intake manifold is pretty cool. So this was a Holley Sniper, I believe, but it's a Holley Sniper copy. It's a Chinese intake manifold I bought. We cut the bottom out of the intake manifold and we put a 1,000 horse Garrett air to water core in it. The throttle body, there's enough room in the valley of these because there's no camshaft, being a dual overhead cam engine, that I can run the intercooler in the manifold and still have room to have half of a tube underneath it to run the throttle body out front. So the air comes in the bottom of the intake manifold, up through the intercooler, and then into the plenum area where all the velocity stacks are for the runners. We've had good luck with this. It's got this pretty big, it's like a 10-gallon air to water tank in the back. I had an engine water pump of some sort on the back, but I can't remember the manufacturer right now. But we recently went to the BMW PWM controlled electric water pump. We have that thing just not full blast all the time. But in a 9-second hit, if we fill that thing up with ice, we'll leave the pass. We'll launch probably, I'd have to look at data, but somewhere around 40, 50 degrees of intake temp by the end of the pass on, again, a 9-second hit in this car being 12 and a half, 13 pounds. By the end of the pass, we'll have temps in the 80 degree range. So it's got a little bit of a rate of incline over the pass. I feel like the core is, I don't know if we're not moving water fast enough. I plan on doing some stuff over the winter to allow us to move water a little bit quicker. Just basically in, I feel that this has a lot of rubber hoses on it, and I feel like they're kinked in some areas, and we can correct that with some solid plumbing. So we're gonna do that. Here's a walk around of the car in that current condition at the time. The best we went in this trim was I believe we went a nine. Again, I don't have video of all this stuff, so I'm a little bad at my numbers. I think we went a 926 at 149 mile an hour. Was how fast we went. Full interior, it was 3,900 pounds with me in it with the 850 cage. Obviously you can see we put a cage in it, and also some pictures of just how the cage fits. It has removable door bars. It's all made out of Dokol R8. Still have the factory dash, all the creature comfort. U car running an N-gauge. The driver's side heat vent is actually used as a mount for the N-gauge, so I don't have to put anything on the windshield. So that wasn't working anyway, so we had to remove the other one from doing the cage, cut out some of the ductwork. It wasn't the end of the world. This thing, we tried to run a factory seat in this initially after I built the cage, but we weren't really, the biggest problem with that was I wasn't able to run my Hans device because the Hans device hit the headrest on the factory seat too much. So. This has a pair of OMP seats in it now that allowed me plenty of room for the Hans device to fit, function, all that jazz. So keep in mind, this thing not only is a stock ECU car, so we're tuning this with HP tuners currently, it's also a completely stock engine. It does have aftermarket oil pump gears in here. These were pretty well known for breaking the oil pump gears when starting to make some horsepower with them. That was one of the first things I did with the car when it was still, I mean, it was probably the first modification I did was put billet oil pump gears in it. Aside from that, the engine is stock. The transmission is stock. It does have a circle D torque converter in it, but the trans itself is 100% factory. The amount of stock stuff in this thing is actually really crazy to me. The rear end, still stock axles. It's welded to with a girdle cover. It does have a true track differential in it. This current setup, we went from leaving in first gear to this is a second gear leave with a set of Ford Racing 410 gears in it. So yeah, again, lots of stock stuff. It's really surprising to me what we're able to get away with on all the factory equipment here. This has got, currently we have a set of injector dynamics 1300s in this. It's got a four innovations triple pump system. We do run their controller. I believe it's called the FC2 is what that controller is we run on this. So we do run CO2 boost control with controlled by boost leash. If you're familiar with that, it's a leash electronics piece. It allows us to do, it's a bump box and a boost controller by time off trans rig release. Or a 2 PSI start pressure, so it'll start the boost ramp on 2 PSI as well if you don't want to use the trans rig release. But we are using that for boost control currently. Power management, it's a little, you don't have as many options with the stock ECU as you would on, say, a Holley or a Haltech. So we're still running a lot of power management stuff with a boost ramp off from the hit. When we went, the best pass to date with this car is an 895 and 153. That was leaving on, I think we left on 10 pounds. We were all in the 20 pounds in 6/10 of a second. So the ramp's pretty short. It is a radial car. We've got the car working pretty well. It has a set of Viking rear shocks on it, the Viking Crusaders. It's a Team Z third link and UPR lowers on this. It's got a UPR anti-roll bar in it as well. The front suspension, it's got a BMRK member with the 1-inch lower engine mounts. It's a strange, double adjustable front strut. I think this thing has 180 pound springs in it currently. I want to put a little bit more spring rate in it. I have these shocks full tight all the time. I just doesn't seem like I can slow it down enough. Partially that's because the car is heavy. Even in this next walk around here, you'll see we gutted all the interior out of it with the aftermarket seats. We ran the hood exit out, ran the hood exit instead of the full exhaust. Even in that trim, the car is still 3,700 pounds with driver. So it's still not a light car, so I think we need some more spring rate up front just to help slow that movement down. It is pretty tunable where it is now, so I'm a little timid to make a spring change up there because it does work on multiple services currently. Okay, so as I said previously to gutting the interior, getting rid of the full exhaust and going to the hood exit, the best the car had been was a 920. Now again, we're trying to break the stock engine record, stock engine and transmission record actually with the car, which is an 867. After we pulled all the weight out to try to break the record, we went to the track, we made multiple passes back to back. First issue we had was getting the transmission to shift, and that ended up being our Achilles heel with this combination. We had hurt the transmission before in the 920 pass, and we hurt it again on the 890 pass. Actually, that was a 571 to the eighth, and the car had been 559 to the eighth, which if you do the math, it was around an 870 pass. That was really promising for us, but we just could not get the transmission to hold the horsepower we needed. Doing a second gear leave means we're running in the fifth gear. We were running in the fifth gear pretty early, being like 5 seconds into the pass. So we broke the thing, was out of the throttle right around 5 seconds into the hit, still went to 559 to the eighth. 1-2-4 60 foot times, the best short time we've gotten with it. But yeah, we ran into a few issues that last day. It was a private test session. Once we realized we weren't going to have fifth gear anymore, I started making just some 330 hits to see what we could get out of it. We ran out of injector. I had to up the base pressure to somewhere around 60 pounds. This is a Force Induction Solutions 80 millimeter Borg Warner base charger. It's a billet compressor wheel, all the Force Induction stuff. It is a T6 132AR hot side with a 96 millimeter turbine wheel. We actually maxed the compressor wheel out, or we're very close to it. If you're familiar with CO2 boost control, I was having to run low 30s for CO2 in first and second gear to make 20 pounds of boost. Once the load got up in the higher gears, I was able to drop that number back down to mid 20s to make 20 pounds. But with what we've talked to a few other people, what we've learned is that the car, that turbocharger is pretty much out of steam in about the same power level we're seeing with other people. Being that the transmission was the Achilles heel here, we are going to put a Turbo 400 in this over the winter. We happen to have a Rossler close ratio Turbo 400 sitting around. It is not the gear set I would like to use. It is a 165 first gear, so pretty low first gear for a 3,700 or 3,900 pound car, depending on what trim we have it in. A bit timid with that. Beans that we're going to trap somewhere in the 160s, we're going to do the 165 first gear with a 410 in the back. That'll still allow us to go out the back door with a little bit of room. I'm not afraid to put a 430 in it if we need more starting line ratio, but I really don't know if that's gonna be necessary. You guys have good luck with these with 189 or 182, whatever powered by first gear is, at 3,900 pounds. So I think the 165 with the 410, I think we'll be okay, but we're gonna try it. Other thing we wanna do is I wanna move to a Holtec ECU rather than the stock ECU. Again, back if you watched the first video, the intentions of when we bought this car was really just to be a daily driver, to learn the tuning side of things, but obviously we've got way carried away with it since then, which is okay. You know, last year I think I drove it to work once. I just don't drive the car very much, so making it more of a race car, I'm not that afraid of it. So getting rid of the overdrive with the Turbo 400 really is kind of what it is. Getting rid of the factory dash in lieu of a Holtec IC7 so I can have all the CAN communication with Holtec work as I'd like. It's more race car stuff, but again, it's kind of what this thing has turned into, and I'm okay with it. I mean, it's got a hood exit, right? How street car can it be? still has AC on the car, still stock engine. Obviously doing the other transmission is gonna take us out of the transmission record thing, but I'm not a trans guy, I'm an engine guy, so I'm okay with that.